You done, Jesse? Well, I don't know what the start time for this is 5:10, so that kind of tells me we've all got mop-up duty. Do we have to all pick up a chair and carry them out and stack them up when we're done? Thank you for joining us. I know it's late in the evening. We're probably the only thing between you and dinner, so thank you for joining us. We're going to be recording this episode as a Speaking in Tech podcast episode, which will be available on the Register on Wednesday. Perhaps this week, perhaps next week, we'll see. But I want to start off and go right down the line with our panelists. This is going to be kind of an interesting panel on OpenStack as a service or as a distribution. And Caroline, we'll start off with you. If you introduce yourself, give your title, and then we'll move right down the line.
Hi, my name is Caroline McCrory, and I run syndicated research at GigaOM.
Hi, I'm Manju Ramanathpura. I work for Hitachi Data Systems. I work in the Office of Technology and Planning, and I focus on network solutions innovation as well as open source innovation within Hitachi.
I'm Jesse Proudman, founder and CTO of Bluebox. I work in the Office of Bluebox, responsible for delivering OpenStack as a service.
In case there's any confusion.
My name is Ken Hui. I used to be at Rackspace on the OpenStack team. Currently, I am at EMC on the Cloud Solutions Business Unit, focused specifically on OpenStack.
Jan Holzer, Red Hat. I'm part of the technology strategy group in Red Hat, focusing on everything infrastructure, deployment of new and emerging technologies, working a lot with our customers.
I'm Boris Rensky. I'm a co-founder and a chief marketing officer at Mirantis.
All right. So this is an all-star panel. Thank you, guys. I want to start this off. The topic of conversation came up in, and Jesse, correct me if I'm wrong, it was a tweet chat conversation that kind of started. It was kind of new to me that we were dissecting OpenStack as a service or as a distribution. It seemed like, wow, how evolved has OpenStack become to now that we're getting into the hard questions about how customers are deploying and leveraging OpenStack. So I want to tee it off with you first with some of your quick thoughts. And Jan, we're gonna go to you next because I really look at Red Hat and Bluebox as kind of the two antagonists here. We're all friendly, but if we're gonna compare a service or a distribution, this is the right folks to have. So Jesse, right off the bat, what spurred this conversation for you? Why? I mean, obviously, you can give us some background on Bluebox, and there's a self-interest you have in that. But there's I know you're philosophical about this as well. So go ahead.
Yeah, so I'm a little biased on the topic. But, I mean, quite frankly, we think distributions are just doing it wrong. we'll throw it out there. What is cloud? I mean, I think that's where we need to start. And the whole premise of cloud, if you look at the NIST definition, is about giving users in an organization elastic resources. And as we've looked at the evolution of what it takes to now deliver that type of technology, you get a really complicated set of software. And so OpenStack itself, people always say, oh, it's like it's a bag of bits. It's something you've got to assemble. The reality is that the elements inside of OpenStack that you must know about to effectively operate an OpenStack cloud, it's an enormous set of requirements. And so what we've seen, particularly in our customer base, is that there's a desire to run a private cloud, yet there isn't the capability to operate that private cloud themselves. And we launched Bluebox Cloud a year ago now at Hong Kong with the intent of delivering OpenStack private clouds as a service. And we were the first company to do that as a productized offering. And we've seen some pretty great success with it over the last year, so much so that we've now got folks like Mirantis joining in the fun. But again, I think the key here is operations teams inside of an enterprise should be focused on building value in their enterprise. And that's often architecting and engineering things that sit on top of the cloud, not the cloud itself. And so if we can make that easier for those operations teams, then it's a win-win for everybody.
John?
Well, I'm biased too, I guess. But I personally believe distros make a great platform for OpenStack as a service provider. So clearly, I think we have a long history of making open source enterprise consumable and also making it scalable in terms of accessible to a large number of customers who just want to consume the technology. The server side, I think, is certainly interesting, and there's certainly a place for it. But I think there are also a lot of challenges around OpenStack as a service for a good number of customers and consumers here. I think the key, and I'm sure Boris has some opinions there as well, is to make OpenStack consumable for customers and provide lifecycle around it, provide the capabilities around upgrades, for example, all the a lot of the enterprise features customers are accustomed to just now running new workloads, and also being able not just to deploy OpenStack only, but usually many customers deploy much more than OpenStack. OpenStack is just a tool underneath for them. They want to add value on top of it, as Jess said, for example, running PaaS platforms, running the applications, and that's really, I think, the value is providing the entire portfolio around it, being it middleware, being it management capabilities across a variety of infrastructure, being it public, being a private cloud, because we certainly see a lot of customers who want to be able to leverage the resources from wherever it makes the most sense to them, which could be on-premise, it could be off-premise. So I don't think there's a single sort of, it must be all on-premise, it must be all off-premise.
Well, I would imagine that Red Hat is kind of like Switzerland here, in the respect that you work with, you've got partners that do both. Right? Is that fair?
Absolutely. And that's kind of my point. Is, I mean, we are more than happy to work with service providers. We don't want to be a service provider ourselves. We are happy to work with service providers. We have a long history of enabling a lot of the enterprise clouds out there based on Linux, based on Red Hat technology. And again, being Switzerland, because it's great to partner, and we don't need to be the one all and be all. So.
Except you run OpenShift as a service, so you are a service provider. Yeah, but I mean, I think I wanted to jump in here real quick and actually step back 1 second. So what is the definition of a service? What is the definition of a distribution? Because I think that's a key.
That's fair.
That's a key component to this. So when we say as a service, what we mean is that there is an external firm that is actually operating the cloud. Blue Box Cloud means we actually run the hardware. It's in our data centers on our hardware. MetaCloud delivers OpenStack as a service on customers' hardware in their data center. So the key distinguishing point is that the operational responsibility for that cloud itself lies to folks outside of the organization and folks who have a specialized skill set. Where distribution is a set of software that is shipped or downloaded or installed, and the operational burden then falls on the actual organization that did that installation. So I think that's a pretty important context to have for this particular discussion.
I want to, real quick, can
actually, would anybody disagree with that definition?
We go to Boris real quick, because you look like you were jumping out to speak before.
I'm getting, yeah.
You're a little shy.
You're avoiding
me.
I'm a shy guy. So, surprisingly, I would like to agree with what Jesse said. I think that this is like a little bit of vague as a service or as a distribution. I think that as with any software, and OpenStack in particular, there is an infinite spectrum of ways to deliver it. And that spectrum you can classify where on one side of the spectrum you have a very opinionated way to do it, and then on the other side you have the way with least opinion. So the example of a way with least opinion would be how Mirantis started is basically doing services around upstream OpenStack bits. So if you're a large Web2O company that is convinced that you know infrastructure better than anybody else around, and you're probably right about it, you have a lot of opinion about how you want it done, and you just need that fill in the expertise gap to just get you there to get running. So this is where you get services. And then you can move down all the way to the other side of the spectrum, which is Rackspace Public Cloud that is using OpenStack bits, but it's not a managed service in their data center or your data center. It's pretty much access to an OpenStack API endpoint for a fixed amount of money. And in between these two, there is a variety of things. So from services, you can move to a distribution where you've, you know, added value on top of the upstream OpenStack by hardening it and making sure that it's easier to consume. You can go to the next step and say that, okay, we're going to help you operate that in your data center. And then you can go to the next step and say, we're going to actually do a managed service type thing where it's our data center. You just tell us, you know, what version of OpenStack you want and how you want it, and we'll just give you OpenStack, but it's going to be your rack with OpenStack running on it. And there's an infinite number of kind of permutations in between, and all of them have value to different types of customers and different use cases.
Great. Ken, you, I know you wanted to chime in there.
Yeah, so first and foremost, all apologies to Jesse. Anyone who tells you there's one best way to do something, they're wrong. there's multiple ways of doing things. There's a lot of customers that I would say you should go ahead and hire a service provider to run your OpenStack for you, because you can't do it yourself and you don't want to. But there's also a lot of companies who would laugh at the idea that they would say, right now I have 10 times the staff you have that manage 10 times the number of servers that you currently have under management. Why am I handing the keys off to you to manage my environment? I'm going to do it myself.
Jesse, that's a fair question. Let's arbitrarily say somebody like eBay, right? Why would eBay want to work with Blue Box?
Yeah, they wouldn't. Like, eBay would do it themselves. And I was going to say to Boris's point, there's absolutely a big spectrum of options. And quite frankly, the large enterprise players, even, I mean, you're a DMC, right? So you're talking with those large enterprise companies. The reality is that the majority of businesses out there aren't eBay. They aren't PayPal. They aren't Facebook. The majority of businesses out there have an IT staff of 5 to 20 people who are already busy on a day-to-day basis, don't have time to learn a new technology, don't have time to learn the operations of a new technology, but need to benefit from private cloud. And so when I say distributions are wrong for that type of consumer, my goal is to get OpenStack in the hands of as many people as possible. But I absolutely agree. I think that the largest organizations will do it themselves because they have that team. So
I think when we talk about enterprises, most of them probably fall somewhere in between. It's not 20 people IT. It's probably about 50 people, 100 people, right? And they're also not like the service providers like eBay or AT&T or telcos. So I think the if I just follow your own trajectory, right? Let's assume that you've got like Blue Box, MetaCloud that are providing private cloud as a service. Maybe say MetaCloud providing an on-prem private cloud. There are thousands and thousands of enterprises, right? So there's going to be a point when, let's say you're a Dr. Evil and you conquer the entire world. You've got like 3-4 really main, the OpenStack service providers for on-prem, right? If you are serving hundreds and hundreds of customers, there's going to be a point at which you are going to optimize how your cloud is delivered as a package software. And that's nothing but a distro in its own way, right? You've just created your own version of a distro. We were on a panel earlier this morning, right? One of the customer was asking, I don't want to, we have like 4 storage vendors, EMC, NetApp, Hitachi Data Systems, SolidFires, and then we had Red Hat. And the guy, gentleman came and asked a question, why don't all the rest of the storage vendors provide your storage as a software as opposed to integrated hardware and a software? Now, if you take that same analogy as a Blue Box providing an on-prem private cloud service, what you're really doing is a cloud in a box, and you're doing it repetitively for hundreds of customers, and you've got a software that is prepackaged like a distro. So the next thing that your customer is going to ask is, why are you packaging your software with the hardware? Just give me the software instead of the hardware. It's just an evolution of, we basically took the storage and evolved ourselves to the cloud. Fast forward maybe 5 years, 10 years down the line, what you're going to have is basically Blue Box distro.
So we have a distro, quote unquote. It's open on GitHub. You can go take our software right now and you can install it on your own infrastructure. The customers that come to us specifically don't want that because they don't have the ability to actually operate it. Like, that's the key is operations,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
So even if I go buy HP Helion, I can still hire HP to manage my installation, right? This trend towards external management of the infrastructure, I think, is really critical. And it's, in my opinion, particular to cloud technologies because of the complexity of the software. This isn't just MySQL. This isn't a single service. Like, and I think that's, in terms of Red Hat, I think that's where I see the greatest challenge, right? Installing a single OS and keeping an OS updated and patched is one thing. But now you've got this massive set of interconnected technologies that becomes a lot more challenging to deal with the failure scenarios on. And we've seen a desire for people in organizations to not have to touch that.
But I think that's just the evolution of, you know, Linux was pretty bad in bad shape too when it got started, and over time it got better. I have a feeling OpenStack, we as a community need to help for OpenStack to get to that point, you know.
Well, I think one thing here is we need to be careful. As we said earlier, there are different market segments as well. Yeah. So I think often the customers you deal with might not necessarily, I would almost say customers, Boris, ourselves, would necessarily target as the ideal candidate for an on-premise OpenStack installation. Because as I said, they're totally overwhelmed by the complexity. We are ignoring the fact that OpenStack is a shiny object. Everybody believes they need to have at least one because everybody else has one. But I would say it's still a box of razor blades you today touch and install blindfolded. So I think the reality is, yeah, for those people who can't deal with the complexity, a service, and I'm keeping service open at this point, if it's like a managed service on-premise of a customer, if it's something like you guys provide. But there's certainly a need for those type of customers to make it as seamless as possible and shield them from a lot of the sharp edges, for example, so they can run their businesses but don't necessarily have to deal with, and they don't have the staffing to do this, so absolutely. And just quickly, because you mentioned OpenShift, so funny enough, so OpenShift was just the reverse part for us, and we are actually not providing really a managed service. We charge for, really, it's a free developer service. But the key for us is we built it to actually understand, gain operational knowledge of running a large-scale PaaS service. And then customers came to us, wow, I would like to run this on-premise. So yeah, exactly happened. And we had to figure out how we actually package this technology to make it consumable for a customer on-premise without having to have X number of people on staff to figure out how all the secret sauce works behind the scenes. But yeah, I think it's a great exercise for us. For example, they actually have real life operational experience, which often, as you deal with vendors, not every vendor has actually real operational experience. And I think you have to know where are the difficult edges or whatnot. So,
Thanks. So I wanted to add that I again agree. I think that actually creating the software and then operating the software are two different things and two different kind of components of value add. Another thing I think is important to keep in mind is you can look at kind of historically how the markets around the same things have evolved. So the distributions are not new and managed services are not new. But the way typically the markets evolve is you typically get a limited number of software vendors or distributions. And then there is operations vendors that do operations around those dominant platforms. So if you go to Rackspace Managed Services and you ask for, I want some virtualization rack, they come to you with some standard solutions. They say you can do Microsoft, or you can do VMware, and by the way, we also have OpenStack, and we'll do managed service for you, right? But it's the Microsoft and VMware, it's the platforms and the distributions that ultimately get the maximum leverage out of their business. Whereas operations model typically scales linearly and is more similar to the services business model, because ultimately to do operations, you need more people for each additional customer which you get, which is a platform, you win the mind share, and you scale it across the ecosystem, and you get other vendors to do operations against your platform.
I'm going to go to Caroline real quick. You've been real quiet here, Caroline. What's?
I'm waiting.
You're waiting to pounce.
Yes.
Go, here's your chance.
I'm like a giant spider that just hides. I actually agree a lot with what Jesse, Boris, and also Ken actually said. I think the biggest mistake that a lot of the vendor companies say is their distributions are the only ones that you should look at and they solve all problems, and it's absolutely not true. Every single vendor has written their product for a specific use case, and it's actually forcing them to admit what that use case is before you actually choose what's actually best for you. Same with the service providers, and as Boris had highlighted, the way Mirantis had started was to do custom, and now they've taken a lot of that knowledge and put it into their distribution, which is mainly being distributed with Fuel and things like that. So it's very important for you to understand what your business is trying to do, what your goals are, and which of these distributions or services has the best service level support that you need, because you are all accountable for different things to your end customers, and they are accountable to you only up to a certain point. So it's, where is your focus? If your focus is your own markets and your own customers, then look to a provider that can deliver the needs that you have to meet your business goals, as opposed to looking at it and being mystified by the technology and not realizing what you're using them actually for. It's very easy to drink the Kool-Aid because, you know, everyone's sitting here looking quite cool.
I want to ask Jesse a question. Jesse, one of the big drivers for private cloud is being able to control of data, security of data, privacy, being, whether you do it poorly or you do it great, in fact, it's all within your grasp. I guess one of the challenges that I have wrapping my mind around OpenStack as a service is that you give up some of that control whenever that data is outside of your building. How do you address that challenge that companies have when it comes to security, privacy, and data control?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think I need to define what Blue Box Cloud is first to answer that. So Blue Box Cloud is a single-tenant OpenStack installation. So every customer that we get gets at least three-node dedicated OpenStack install that belongs just to them. So at any point in time, we can walk into our data center with that customer or with their auditor and say, this machine, and that machine comprise where your data is. So what we tried to do was blend the benefits of public cloud, elasticity, time to market, OpEx billing, and the benefits of private cloud, which is data sovereignty, control of the environment, control of cost, and integration to existing environment into one unified offering. So because we're not sharing anything, there's dedicated SANs, there's not a shared SAN. There's dedicated firewalls, there's no shared firewall. So everything in the environment belongs to that customer. In our opinion, we can get the same level of isolation that you can get on-premise just without the operational burden.
But what about, and I'm going to cherry pick here, it may not be fair, but if you look at, and Caroline, we've had discussions in the past about the Microsoft issue and the data sovereignty issues that came up with the Ireland cloud email accounts. If you've got a customer that, let's say the federal government, wants to grab their data, and we'll assume it's encrypted as part of the service, what's to stop them for accessing that data? And I know it would be a little bit, I'm making a couple of distinctions here. If it's on-prem, you know, within their four walls, and it gives them the right to at least be alerted to such an action, where conceivably, if they're using a service provider, it's outside their four walls, they may not even be aware that there's an action to seize that data in the first place. And I know it's an extreme case, and 99.59% of customers are never going to see that type of experience. But how do you handle that? How do you manage that control of data aspect?
Yeah, that's a great question. So, we have corporate policies in place. We're Safe Harbor certified. So we follow all the legal proceedings that we can to ensure that there are policies in place to prevent that type of action or to communicate it to customers if it occurs. Sure, we've received subpoenas before, and we've had to respond accordingly. And yes, I think that is a valid concern for being outside of a corporate facility. But the reality is that, in my experience, that's primarily FUD. Like, at the end of the day, majority of organizations aren't going to have to deal with that type of concern. And if you have that concern in your data, then you're probably going to put it on-prem. Like, there are use cases for all these technologies. The other thing that's unique is that we've architected the solution so that we can drop into data centers around the world. So instead of having these centralized hyperscale facilities like a public cloud provider does, we could theoretically be in 120, 250 data centers around the globe. And so we can get into more countries. So you look at like Amazon building their Frankfurt facility. Like, we could have a German facility. We have a Swiss facility right now. We could have a London facility. And so by getting into the countries of origin for where that data is, you start to get over some of the challenges of that data sovereignty question.
Caroline, did you?
Yeah, so I think the old way of thinking about building systems was always, where are my servers? Where am I going to put them? Where are my data centers? And therefore, that's where my servers have to be. And if we start thinking about things more as a service, and everything is going towards applications, if you understand which applications you have that need to be internal or external and have data that it needs to access that are internal or external, that will help you actually decide and architect what you have as a distribution if you have to choose, and what you have as a service, again, also if you have to choose. It's making the focus back on the applications and the data the applications need to access, as well as where the users are coming from of those applications, that will help you decide the geolocations of where you have them. And then obviously the rules of the geolocation, like what Jesse is saying, you know, being having something in Frankfurt because there are certain, you know, legal requirements for the apps that you're going to have there versus somewhere else. And then it's also very much to do with where the data is going to be located that are going to be accessed, because that will change how you also architect your application landscape.
Boris, I just want to ask Boris real quick. How often do you get that question about control of data within the sphere, especially with OpenStack?
You know, we do get it from time to time, but I can't say that it's a predominant concern at this point. And in all honesty, I think that the model where OpenStack is consumed as kind of a, you know, as a managed platform, it's definitely going to be something that's a market, that's an emerging market. But if you were to, for example, you know, ask Rackspace right now, you know, how much of managed OpenStack they do versus managed VMware, it's, you know, a silly question. I think that the main market that we've seen for OpenStack is among, still to date, fairly kind of a high-tech, kind of a high-tech web SaaS type organizations that are adopting OpenStack with a vision not to replace something necessarily, but to solve for the problem that OpenStack is the only solution that can be solved, meaning, you know, build the internal Amazon. And most of these projects are still early, and most of these projects are always on-prem, and the customers always control everything. And they answer this question themselves. So, you know, when we build an environment for WebEx or we build an environment for PayPal, they don't come to us asking us about, you know, the data security problem. They can take out distro, and we can help them implement it in a particular way, but they ultimately control the entire thing, and yeah. This is a way to kind of avoid this question altogether.
Understood. So the title of this panel is Ask the Expert. So if anybody's got any questions in the audience, please, there's two microphones over here. Stand up to the microphone, and we'll jump to it. Kenneth, I know you want, or just yeah. Kenneth or Jesse, take your pick. Okay.
Thanks. So I think what we just talked about kind of speaks to the fact that while there's definitely certain use cases where you definitely want to use private cloud as a service, whether it's Blue Box, Mirantis, there's also a lot of use cases where you have to do it yourself. And so it's important, I think that's where the hybrid cloud comes in, right? Whatever you choose, you should choose something where you can actually be able to talk from your private on-prem environment to an off-prem environment and be able to put the workload in the right place. And I think that's one aspect that almost all the businesses have it wrong to date, which is they don't look at their workloads to examine which one should go where. They just basically say which saves me the most money in the short term.
That's right. Well, let's go to our first question. You give us your name if you wouldn't mind.
Hi, I'm Rania Mosier. I'm currently a software development manager at Rackspace working on the public cloud deployment system. So whenever y'all talk about Rackspace, I'm like, huh, really, it's that easy, huh? So for me, we are packaging our own. It's not a pretty package, it's not elegant, but we are packaging code and configs from upstream OpenStack with our internal changes. I know that right now we are stuck on a Debian distro and kind of in a lockstep of how the heck do we upgrade this? We're also kind of stuck in that same problem with Zen Server. What's to keep distros from making that same pain point problem? Because little clouds grow up to be big clouds. And so for me, where I'm standing, a distro just, for the large-scale use cases that we're going to continue to see with research and development, with large-scale data management, I have concerns about the distro path, and so I'm just curious what you have. I am biased.
So I can try and answer that question. I guess my question to you is in reply to this. I wanted to understand that you work in the public cloud part of Rackspace or the managed services part of Rackspace.
So the managed services is just a new level of support offering. The infrastructure is there. You either can get public cloud services with basic text support, or you can get public cloud services that give you the full managed.
But I think you're talking about Rackspace private cloud.
I'm talking about Rackspace managed offering. Like, I can come to Rackspace now and say, Rackspace, I want a rack with VMware on it. Tell me how much it's going to cost.
I am in the public OpenStack cloud, not okay. in the VMware.
Okay.
Business.
So yeah. So the That's a good clarification point.
Yeah, Wednesday morning I'm going to talk about how we deploy to 42,000 things in the public cloud, how we deploy OpenStack.
Right, so when it comes to a certain level of scale, I think distribution is not necessarily a way to go, especially if what you're doing is your core business. So when it comes to, Rackspace Managed Service and Rackspace Public Cloud are two very different types of business. So Rackspace Public Cloud, in my opinion, is closer to what AWS is. And because of that, the OpenStack bits that you guys are working on and the entire infrastructure underneath is really part of the core value proposition that Rackspace delivers to the customer. And moreover, because it's a public cloud, you can actually kind of do the Amazon model where you have a fairly uniform infrastructure underneath and your own distro that you roll with a lot of resources dedicated specifically to this distro. And you know, in that case, when you're talking a lot of scale, distribution is not a way to go. You don't want to go with a third-party vendor. And this is really the same reason why OpenStack has been attractive to large-scale infrastructure operators like Workday or PayPal, because they don't want a distribution. They want to have their own thing, much like you guys roll for the public cloud.
Great, thank you. We have another question here. Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, go ahead.
I probably should chime in too.
Yes, you should.
We somehow have a fight and a dog in this fight as well. So, I think we certainly have proven that having a distro as a stable base gives you a great platform for building a very large scale infrastructure, because again, you get a stable base with all the life cycle around it, updates, etc. You don't have to do this yourself. So first of all, second of all, I think it is really important. We all like to talk about, well, OpenStack and OS and whatnot, but there's a very tight coupling today, realistically, between OpenStack as a platform, the underlying OS, a lot of interaction. I think you want to make sure that sort of at least the platform you deploy is going to work, and you don't have to sort out interaction between, say, I don't know, networking, kernel drivers, name it, namespace support, whatever it might be, on your own, and effectively not just create your own OpenStack distro, but also create your own your own operating system distro, for example. So I think the key really is provide, first of all, infrastructure support around lifecycle management, deployment, etc., but also on a higher level, and that's not necessarily direct as important to Rex, because you do it a lot on yourself, as you will do the talk on Wednesday, but for a lot of the enterprise customers on premises, also to unify the operational aspect of their different environments, because not every customer, actually no customer almost, has just OpenStack in their environment. They have a lot of other stuff, as Boris said, like VMware, other stuff in the virtualization space, and for them, I think it's really important to have a unified operational surface for example, making provisioning consistent, providing workload orchestration across multiple infrastructures rather than just have these silos and managing each of these silos separately, having different skills, etc., but reuse skills as much as possible. So anyway.
That's great. I do want to keep this brief. We got 5 minutes left. We got another question here, so I want to make sure we address it.
Yeah, my name is Michael Delzer. For me, the biggest issue is, whether it be a service or a distribution, is the fact that I need people to be consistent on a common API and a common process, because I want to avoid the Enron effect. Because back in when Enron, before it closed, no one thought the company would go down. So I want to use multiple cloud vendors, multiple cloud solutions, but I need them to be identical. I've tried using Amazon, and it's a unique environment, but it's very proprietary to them, and it makes it difficult to have one kind of application delivery model to work in an Amazon, because that's a totally unique ecosystem. And the reason why I'm looking at OpenStack for American Airlines is I want the ability to have a common application deployment model independent of who it, is actually running it for us.
Cloud Foundry. No, but I think this is the biggest challenge with OpenStack today, and I think there's a lot of work that's going into RefStack and to DefCore to try to figure out interoperability between all the vendors. From my perspective, I think we're almost thinking about it the wrong way. And if we look at something like platform as a service, like Cloud Foundry, that can talk to Google, that can talk to Amazon, that can talk to OpenStack, that can talk to VMware, you've now really solved that multi-cloud API challenge. I think there are still holes there in the service catalog, like database caching, queuing. Like those things aren't solved or consistent across all the platforms. But that's how we are thinking about it here.
Yeah, for me, the big that I'm planning on doing a Cloud Foundry type pattern, but I also have to support the Microsoft people, and Mongo is not going to be, Mono is not going to be an operational viable for us. So I still need someplace to host Microsoft type applications.
So I echo one Jesse's comment. I think when you have, earlier when I said that you should focus on your applications, I mean that you should focus on your applications. So with you, at least you're already looking at that and you're trying to figure out how you can get your apps to work across all the different clouds. And in that sort of scenario, PaaS is actually the best way to do it because you're letting the PaaS be the one to do the integration. You're just focusing on the apps, which is what your business actually requires. And I know, Jan, you made a face when Cloud Foundry was mentioned. I'm going to take this opportunity to say, I'm still waiting for Red Hat to come back and give me 5 OpenShift customers that I can go and talk to as part of my research.
I can give you 10.
All right.
We're going to have to keep you 2 separate. Look, we just got a few minutes left. There's another question here. Let's get the question. We'll hit the home stretch here.
So, Devananda, just to follow up on that question, between the service providers and the distro providers up there, whose responsibility is it to make sure that everyone who's providing a cloud is providing the same set of APIs, the same set of services, and adhering to RefStack and DevCore and all of that work?
Good question. John, you want to go ahead and tackle that one first?
So I think there are a couple of areas. One is sort of the API side, where clearly OpenStack has the potential of becoming a de facto infrastructure for a lot of those public cloud, private cloud infrastructures. Today, the reality is the major public cloud providers are not running on OpenStack, so you don't get sort of the consistent API easily. You could use OpenStack on top of, say, EC2. I would probably argue for a long time might not be the ideal approach today. We believe there's...
Please don't.
Well, I try to be nice. But we believe there's a better layering on top of it. The other part is also, for example, providing the capability to the customer to deploy reliably their OS instances between cloud providers, get certification across cloud providers. So there's, for example, a program we have called the Red Hat Certified Cloud Provider Program. So all cloud providers providing Red Hat, like in Amazon, they are certified cloud provider, and there's agreements around support, SLAs, etc. So when you call up Amazon or call up us, somebody actually picks up the phone and has guaranteed response, for example. And you can also move your subscription between these environments seamlessly rather than having to, I need to buy here, I need to buy here, for example.
Clarify my question real quick. I don't mean Amazon. I mean between OpenStack clouds.
Right.
Right. And what you propose basically just locked you into Red Hat. So you So now you're basically saying I'm not even. You're not proposing compatibility between OpenStack clouds. You just need to do Red Hat and.
No, that's not what I said.
That's what you said. You said just you choose a federation of Red Hat clouds and we're good.
No.
In all seriousness, I think this is the foundation's responsibility.
Yeah. So and I am on the board, so I can speak to that. So I think that actually, there's been a lot of kind of Red Hat marketing probably here, but I think that actually that's an accurate answer, because the RefStack and the DevCore and all of this foundation-driven initiatives, in my opinion, to enforce API compatibility between different distributions and different vendors, in my opinion, is a lost cause. And I think that ultimately what's going to happen is a certain number of vendors will evolve that roll their own distribution. And with that distribution, certain set of APIs, they just naturally comes in. And these vendors are who's going to be defining the standard, not the foundation for like the RevStack initiative.
Yeah, we got another question. We're gonna tie it off after this one, I swear.
I just want to follow up on him. You just mentioned PaaS as the solution to solve.
If you could get closer and speak louder, please.
The IaaS interoperability problems. How do you convince SAP to run on Cloud Foundry?
I think they're actually a Cloud Foundry Foundation member, so they're looking at it. How long will it take? Forever.
The man wants answers. Yeah. He wants a solution.
I'll write it tomorrow. I think that's a big challenge. But you look at, and I call it Cloud Foundry in particular because it to me mimics the OpenStack Foundation and its membership in a similar and governance model. It's going to take a while, but we're headed in the right direction in that capability.
Uh-oh.
I guess let's just put it this way. I mean, there's constant flux, right? I mean, what you do is basically there's this concept of an unfair advantage from the startup world. So you basically sell a service because other people don't have the skills. So obviously that will move, things will get easier, so your unfair advantage will come down. And if your money that you ask for that is too much, then people will move away. And if you go to Cloud Foundry, then there will be OpenShift, and other people will go to OpenShift, and then these are not interoperable, and then it will move higher up. I mean, it's just constant motion, right?
I don't know if Jesse's got an unfair advantage because the rest of the market doesn't have the technical expertise, but...
I'll take that.
It's an advantage.
No, unfair advantage compared to whatever traditional enterprises, right?
Sure.
Which don't have the skills.
I say yes. So I think that the operations model ultimately, you can charge a premium around the solutions that are new and hard, like OpenStack. And when it becomes mainstream and when it's down to three distributions, then this becomes the same business as managing VMware cluster. So it's a commodity business with a gazillion vendors in it that are, fighting for thin margins.
So
but, you can
disagree with that as somebody who's running that business. But, the key for us is not to differentiate by adding people every time we add a customer. The key is to differentiate in building a technology platform that gives us the ability to actually deliver this on a consistent basis as a product. And to scale revenue, to scale installs without scaling headcount. And that's exactly what we've done. I think it's a fundamentally different approach than how anybody has tried to do private cloud. Like if you go look at Rackspace private cloud, if you look at IBM private cloud, if you look at any of the other folks that are out there delivering a hosted private cloud, the implementation is very different than how we've approached things.
Well, I think that this is like the key. So where you're going, I think, in my opinion, is more like towards the Amazon model. So you can automate everything, you can have a uniform data center with a uniform kind of orchestration layer on top of it, and still you get commoditized to some extent. But when it comes to managed offerings, ultimately, so some customer comes to you and they tell you, I want a rack that looks like this. I want three nodes with such and such configuration. I want four. You need people to go ahead and set up that environment. You can't have, you can set up a data center full of uniform infrastructure and then automate everything out of it. If that's what you do, then you're going to the Amazon model, not a managed services model.
All right.
This is coming from the consulting company, though.
Like okay. All right, guys, I think we're way over time now. I'm sorry, Boris. You can go punch him out in the hallway. We'll take care of it right there. All right, I want to thank our panelists for what a great discussion. Lots of food for thought. And thank you for coming. Really appreciate it. Thank you. Go grab some food and some drinks.